All right, if you're having a little trouble, you're not alone. We understand this. The last couple of videos have been so powerful that it has dredged up these scripts, mental scripts, that are quite troublesome. Last night I had this terrible dream of being a fugitive and being hunted by the government and or at least powerful governmental figures that were, and it was just wow. The feeling of being a fugitive, always on the run, is something that seems to be in this world rather common, and that's certainly how I felt. That and yet it seems like somehow this script that we have is keeping things upside down and backwards, trying to keep us from realizing truth, as if truth is a dangerous criminal, right? That's what the world believes, of course. And so even though we may not feel so great, which I certainly don't feel great at all right now, this is it, whether ready or not. You know, that game, Ready or Not, Here I Come, the tag game, is doesn't matter if we say, well, we're not ready. Doesn't matter. This is it. We're in the 15-month phase now, and certainly everything is going along as expected in the world. The pressure that everyone's being put under to conform to the cosmic corporate culture is just extraordinary. Cosmic corporate culture wants to flatten and homogenize all ideals, all high aspirations, everything down into just a sort of a bland consumer soup. And this is what they're after. So they want to create a very homogenized society in which everybody is just like happy sheep grazing on materiality. So if you hold up higher standards than cosmic corporate culture wants, they're, you know, the brown shirts are after you. Certainly, we have a right to set standards which challenge us. And cosmic corporate culture says, no, we don't want you to be uncomfortable, we don't want you to be challenged, we want you to be happy with our governance and our belief system here. But we're supposed to be held to a higher standard. Now, we went to Easter Vigil, which is the night before Easter, and 3 hours, and you get the whole show. And I came away from that saying, you know, we deserve better. We deserve better. It's a mishmash. It's just a mishmash of various teachings. And I couldn't make heads or tails, though, to not tell you the truth. Even after a whole lifetime of living with these beliefs in this society, it's just wow, what a mishmash. They sort of every now and then you hear something that says, ah, you know, maybe that might be not good, and then you hear something else that's like, oh no, you know, it's that's what is that? And I saw the I felt what's going on there. Actually, I felt the you see the people the those who are entering the faith being baptized, pour water over their heads, and they have this sort of this pitcher, like in the form of a shell or something, in this big tub, baptismal font, a tub of water, big brown bowl, huge round bowl, and the one to be baptized bends their head over the bowl, and the priest puts the hand on the neck, and then scoops a ladle of water, big ladle of water, like a seashell, huge seashell, so to speak, and then it just, and it says, I baptize you, and then it pours over the crown of their head, so the water goes back into the font, baptismal font. It says, in the name of the Father, then scoops some more water in the Son, and then scoops some water in the Holy Spirit. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then they get a towel for their head, and then they're led into the reception area or some area, and then the next one. So they baptize all these candidates, and then they confirm the final confirmation for a whole lot of candidates who've gone through the who are now admitted into all the sacraments, full faith. One of the second sacrament would be the Eucharistic, First Communion. So some of them actually took First Communion, which is a communion wafer. And then the other group, they've already done that, and now they're finally full-fledged Catholics is what it was. So you get to see all of this oil on the forehead, you know, and everybody's clapping, and there's this huge, you know, collective familial support, you know, invoking God and all this stuff. And I came away from this feeling like, you know, reality doesn't need any rituals. Reality is ritual free. Yes, I already know that there will never be any rituals in reality. Yes, I already know that there never will be any rituals in reality. Yes, I already know that there are no rituals in reality, that there never will be any rituals in reality. Reality is ritual free. Yes, I already know that reality is ritual free. And I feel like rituals are needed to sort of distract you from mistakes, errors. So you're so caught up in the pomp and circumstance and ritual and all the stuff that's happening, and the incense is flowing, and they're putting holy water on you, and everybody is holding their hands out, and we lit the candles, and you know, it's just like this huge ritual. It's just like, and then, but the teaching is not right. But we tend to say, well, everything else is so nice, like the frame is so nice, and who cares about what the picture is? It'll kind of distract you from what the picture is. So I came away feeling like that, well, that reality doesn't need any rituals at all. Doesn't even need a frame. Now, healed perception is like a frame, but ultimately reality doesn't need a frame. It's a frame that reassures us that reality doesn't need a frame. It doesn't need any ritual at all. It's ritual free. There's no ritual that reality is engaged in at all. And my attitude was just observer, you know, neutral. I've been to Easter vigils before, and this one was I just had a more observational, full context situation there. And you know, they had a fantastic chorus and music group, just done superbly, and so the whole thing was this huge, beautifully orchestrated spectacle with the fine dress of the priests officiating and just the whole atmosphere, you know, and then you can see. I said, so it's like there's sort of this collective expectation that you need to do this for us. This, you know, and how to get free of all of this is the question, and I sort of had a feeling for it. That all of these false beliefs we have, we can be set free of them in just an instant, easily. But we don't see it that way. We don't believe that. We believe somehow that we're like really bound to it all. But I saw that we're not actually bound to it at all. Not at all. And it's possible to have just a little shift where you simply recognize you're not bound to any of it. And there's no trauma in this shift at all. It's very interesting. Because I saw the collective pressure, the social pressure, the belief pressure, everything that's being, you know, the priests are invoking, you know, just this whole heavenly hierarchy, and you're here, and you're now a family of the living, you know, not of the dead anymore. And you're charged with all these great responsibilities of living in the light and all of this. So, you know, it sounds great, and it sounds like super important. Except the whole explanation they have of reality is completely cuckoo, you know. And so you feel like, wow, it's going to be super difficult and traumatic to ever let go of this conditioning. Because I was just wondering, how are all these beautiful spirits here ever going to get free of this conditioning? Because it seems like you know, they don't want to lose the beauty of the ritual and ceremony. And of course, it was very, very appealing, you know, really. But they feel, well, I don't want to lose that. And so I feel I need to hold on to the beliefs, the underlying belief system, so I don't lose the beauty of the ritual and all this stuff. And that's a very strong catch. Yeah, you know, the whole thing was there. The whole thing was there, and so I was a witness to it all, and so in that way, it's a great experience. And then I did have this sort of epiphany. Oh wow, so this is what we struggle with is this notion of somehow some sort of rendering trauma, some terrible wrenching trauma. And I feel it's not there at all. And I felt like, you know, like there's like a guru, a saint, or the inner teacher. In a moment, just like this, it just some little shock can just, you know, free us up from this whole construct. In an instant, we realize, oh, it wasn't traumatic at all. As soon as we realize, oh, it wasn't traumatic, then, oh, we're free of it. You know, so it's like that. We have a misconception of how difficult it is. We don't want to betray our fellow acolytes. We're part of this, you know, religious family. We're part of something very important. We're, you know, but really, to be truly helpful, you must be free of the false perception. That's the problem. False perception is the problem. So the wow here is that it's actually totally easy, and yet we're thinking it's going to be horrendously difficult and miserable. This is the price we pay for surrounding our false perception with, you know, the dignity of beautiful ritual. God is not an angry, vengeful, killing force that kills the enemies of the Jews or kills the enemies of the righteous or, you know, does all this stuff. It's not like that. We've anthropomorphized. We're worshiping a god of our own belief that seems to agree with all of the troubles that we suffer in false perception, which is really an attempt to overcome God, be greater than God. And so we believe in a god that is helping us defeat God, essentially. This is what we worship, a god that is helping us defeat God, to be greater than God, and confirming that this effort is will work and is successful. And then we're given the feeling that if we get free of that, it's somehow going to be devastating to us. And then I saw, no, it's actually not devastating at all. And yet, how can you convey that to anyone who's not able to see it that way? Wow, no wonder why they're so frightened. Everybody's so frightened. Like, oh my gosh, no, this is terrifying. Now, all throughout, I'm saying I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. There's absolutely no way to ever. There's nothing that can ever, absolutely nothing can ever be said about reality. There's absolutely nothing that can ever be said about reality. It's absolutely true, completely indescribable. And there's another one. There's nothing is ever relative to reality. There's absolutely nothing that is ever relative to reality. There's nothing that is relative to reality. See, that relative to reality means or implies there's something that's out different than reality, outside of it, that's related to it. There's nothing related to reality. There's absolutely nothing that is ever relative to reality. There is nothing relative to reality whatsoever. God does not relate things to reality. There's only reality. There's nothing outside of God. There's nothing outside of reality. There's nothing related to reality. Yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing that can ever be related to reality. Yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing that can ever be related to reality. Now, a word about this practice that we're doing. It certainly brings up backlash. And the better you get at handling this backlash, the better it will go for you. You have to get better at it, myself included with this. And what I suggest is when you're feeling like, wow, just not, you know, it sort of creeps up on you and you're just feeling kind of bad and you're feeling it's difficult, wow, ask yourself, what phase of the practice am I in? Am I in asserting? Am I doing assertions? No? Okay, wow, full stop, I'm feeling the wowness of it, right? So, usually it's we're feeling the wowness of it. And so, when you recognize this and say, oh great, okay, and then you pull yourself right back into practice mode, oh, okay, and I need to practice the wow. And start practicing the wow, full stop, neutral, not seeking for any feeling of success at all. And also, not experiencing any feeling of failure either. And then once you get this consciously, you're in the wow consciously, then you can start working on flipping the script. And you begin to flip the script on this very, you know, backlash negative script that's trying to keep you down, pursuing you, turning you, making you think you're a fugitive, fleeing from justice, that kind of stuff. And when you do this, you immediately, as soon as you recognize, hey, wait a minute, yeah, I need to, I'm practicing what? Oh, wow, I'm in this wow phase. It's, you know, very strong wow. You will find like you just turn the tide. You turn the tide, and you say, wait a minute. Why am I running? Why am I fleeing? Why am I feeling this way? I don't need to feel this way. No, it's everybody else that is fleeing from truth. I'm not fleeing from truth. And you start to push back, like work on flipping the script that is keeping you down in fear, in a fugitive status. Now, I came in this dream I had as this fugitive and this very powerful politician. Maybe I won't identify them because I'm not, you know, it's a dream symbol. What was that? Someone crushed a can. Well, they were trying to crush me, to say the least. Get him. And, I had to drive over a curb, a sidewalk and a curb. It was, you know, marked red, and I read, hey, you can't go there. And I left the parking lot, and I'm driving down a road, and I'm trying to, I pulled into some parking lot, and went back behind the parking lot, trying to hide from the police. There's a big chase, you know, dragging it on me. I felt like, you know, it was like being broadcast on the news everywhere. It says, have you seen this person? If you have, dangerous, apprehend them, call the police immediately. I said, oh my gosh, they're using all the media, you know, social media, everyone's on the lookout for me to capture me. It was some powerful senator, head of the some super important Senate committee, they were claiming that I'm dangerous, you know, really dangerous. And I went into this market. I was in desperate, you know, like full fugitive feeling, like everybody can imagine there's a huge dragnet out for you and everybody's looking for you, how you would feel. And there's this man there. And he smiled at me and laughed, and he said, "Ah," he said, "Oh, so you that do you feel you're being pursued, huh? You're in that pursuits thing, huh?" I said, he says, "Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry at all. Easy," he says, "easy to get free of that." I says, "Yeah." In other words, he seemed completely aware of what my feelings were, and laughed and chuckled at it. You know, says, "Ah, there's no worries about that. This is we'll turn that around, no problem." I said, how? Yeah. He says, "Oh yeah, it's don't be concerned, don't be concerned. You won't be pursued anymore. We can deal with this. Not a problem at all. It's not even a problem." You know, in other words, total reassurance. Just laughed it off like it's nothing. I said, "Huh." Then he pointed out like this lady who's with him. She was all dressed up in like shawl, some huge white shawl wrapped around like a renunciate, you know, just like that. Looked like Ananda Maima, the all white, just a white sari, a white shawl, you know. And he said, "As a matter of fact, this one here," he said, "is an expert, total expert at being able to deal with this and turn flipping this around." I said, "Oh, really? Yeah." And then this lady looked like a holy lady or some very odd, you know, being. Smiled at me and said, "He said yes, yes, yes." And they weren't the slightest bit bothered by it at all. And I said, "How's that possible? I got the whole government, the whole world is like having this dragnet to apprehend me. and they're not in trouble by it one slightest bit." And this lady, I saw their hair was like so long it reached like to the ground basically, and it was like in like some sort of like dreadlocks or something, but you know, dreadlocks, I came up with like dreadnoughts. Dreadnoughts. What means dreadnought? I mean, don't dread. Someone who's expert at not dreading, not having any dread. You know, which I was in a state of severe dread. I felt dreadful. Right? And don't a lot of us feel dreadful sometimes? I certainly do. If you ask yourself, "How do I feel?" I say, "I feel dreadful." I feel, which is better than terrible. I feel terrorized, but I feel dreadful, this feeling of dread. Like somehow, I'm a fugitive in this world. You know, the world is out to apprehend me. Well, the world certainly is very defended against truth. It's out to apprehend any truth, for sure. So I just happened to run into this store, hiding. I want to hide in the store. Hopefully they couldn't see my car behind there. And they said, "Don't worry, don't dread. Dread not." And they happened to be there. So, well, and I feel that there is this way to flip the situation. It's the world that is in fear, and it's terrified by truth. And the previous video to this one, it certainly explains why. And I can't quite, you know, bring it to mind what it is at this point. Because I'm in the wow shock phase of the reaction to that video. The reaction to that video is very strong in the collective psyche of the world. Very strong. They feel it's a threat to psychic security, you know, their security of their psyche. Now, it's very possible that you come into this world and you are confronted with a world full of people who are fugitives. They're fleeing truth. And if you come here to help the world, you're going to run into many, 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 many who have this desperate fear, this desperate fear. And so the way to do it is to not identify with that fear, but to tell them, well, reassure them. Oh, there's no reason. Don't worry. No reason to be alarmed. It's the same technique as if someone asks you a question. What they're really afraid of is someone asking them that question. Okay. But you don't want to try to answer the question. You just say, don't worry, just tell whoever asked you that question, tell them the same thing. Say, well, you know, you don't have to answer that question. There's nothing you can say about reality at all. There's no way you can flee from reality. So we're trying to look at something here, a technique. It's sort of like we all want to be helpful, and so we have this problem. So, well, in order to be helpful, I have to solve this problem. What we have to tell people is no. You don't have to be helpful by solving any problems. There isn't any problem. It's an assumed problem. It's an assumption that somebody has a problem, and this virus has been passed along. Everybody's infected with it. Suppress the sneeze there. Wow. I'm getting better at that now. I believe that the answer is that there isn't any problem. There's nothing that can be said at all about reality. There's nothing that will ever relate to reality. There's nothing to relate to reality at all. This position has to be maintained. Otherwise, we are most definitely going to identify with this fear that everyone in the world has. And this is our problem. So to get free of the problem, we don't have to answer any question. We don't have to find some hiding place or anything like that. We just have to make sure that those who come to us who are frantic like this, that we don't try to answer their question of how to solve something or hide, how to solve a non-existent problem or things like that. Otherwise, we'll get hooked into it. So you pass it on down the line. Like someone comes to me, will ask a question, I say there isn't any need to answer that question, you know. And they say, yeah, but what if someone asks me that question? I say, my advice would be simply tell them, ask them, say, well, when somebody else asks you, when someone asks you that question, you know, what are you going to say? And just tell them to say the same thing. When someone asks you that question, what are you going to say? And so we keep this chain effect where nobody's put in a position of answering the question. There isn't any question about reality. So this attitude of those two beings in the dream transferred over to me. I get that attitude to say, I'm not being chased by anyone. What are you talking about? I'm not a fugitive. There's nothing wrong whatsoever. Then I can say to someone else that, you know, their attitude when someone comes to them is like that. And to tell them that their attitude should be to someone who comes to them, whose attitude needs to be that which someone comes to them, and it is endless chain like that. It's an endless chain that way. There's nobody ever stuck with having to deal with this. Now, I've certainly been flipping the script in that way more and more and more. I've been able to get into this mental state where I'm very assertive of just, I can see answers to, you know, people try to pressure me. I'm able to be exactly spot on in how to just absolutely put that in the right context. Because when people come to you for help, if you're like frightened, really, they're feel incapable of dealing with a situation of somebody else coming to them asking for help. So they might come to you and say, what they're really saying is, hey, people are coming to me for help. I don't know how to help them. How do I help them? You know, that sort of thing. And you help them by saying, look, when someone comes to you for help, you know, that's the question. You don't need help, actually. You need to keep reassuring everyone that nobody needs any help. This whole idea of we have a problem is a virus. It's a belief virus. So those two beings in the dream just told me that there's nothing wrong. This is, don't worry at all. There's no worries whatsoever. It's like a joke. They just laughed it off like a joke. I was like, huh? So, and at the root of this, I feel that there's someone that we feel needs an answer to justify everything that we've done. There isn't any justifying of what we've done because we haven't done anything. Now, of course, this idea of having children and civilization and all of governance and all that, we think we've done something, you know, and so we need to justify it, and this is where we've run into trouble. We haven't done anything. Because we assume that all this is based on discerning a flaw in reality. So we've discovered a flaw in reality, or we're in the process of discovering a flaw in reality, or in the process of fixing it. So we feel that we've done something. We haven't done anything. There's nothing happening in reality, to reality. There's only the spontaneity of the now always taking place. So, when we, maybe they're out to apprehend me now, you know, like, it's like, oh my gosh, I gotta go. You know, they're after me. What have I done? What have I done? So the way they flip the script, the ego flips the script on you, is they say, well, I thought you wanted to help me. I said, no, I don't want to help. I don't want to help anyone. I don't need to help anyone. There's nothing wrong. But I will reassure you that you don't need help, so to speak. You know, that I will reassure you that all is perfect, all is well. There is no flaw. When they say, I thought you want to help me, meaning they're trying to get rid of the consequences of believing that there's a flaw in reality, which is fear, and all the different ways that fear appears as we defend against it. And we say, no, I'm not trying to help you with that, because there isn't any flaw. How can I help you overcome the consequences of what doesn't exist? There aren't any real consequences. So what are we doing here? We're working to flip the script, is what we're doing. Very dreadful script. Script full of dread. So everyone is believing they need to help. They're desperate for help to deal with these dreadful consequences of finding a flaw in reality and thinking that God is so upset and it's disturbed reality. Everything is just completely trashed and say, oh my gosh, what do? We got to build a new life, you know, for separate from reality. And so they're so concerned about how to do this. And we're just here to say that none of this is true. It's like a dream. So running into these two beings in the market, all I need to do is listen to them. They said, oh, there's no reason for any dread or concern. Nothing's wrong. Don't worry at all. You have no worries. There are no worries. What are you worried about? I said, oh, they're all after me. They said, no. Don't worry about that. So no reason to worry at all. I said, wow. And no reason to worry about it. You know, that's great. And just imagine if you were in this state of just total dread, of a global dragnet that everybody's out to capture you. You know, you're like the most wanted fugitive in the world, and someone just completely dismisses your dread and says, oh, there's no reason to worry whatsoever. You say, oh, what would you do? Would you say they're crazy and keep running, or would you listen to them? So I listened to them. I said, huh? Is that possible? And I said, yeah, you know, they had some quality that reassured me. You know, it's possible. Of course, there's still part of me saying, no, what are you talking about? Don't listen to them. But how did they know exactly how I felt? And they had this great attitude of... They laughed it off like, oh, yeah, we've seen this a million times, you know. This is what we deal with. Here's another one. So this full stop on the wow is very important, okay? Because we don't let dread get a hold of us. We do not let dread get a hold of us. And that is very crucial. We don't flee. If we hear those sirens, we don't just go into escape mode. Just imagine if every siren you heard, you felt that was some authorities coming for you. And this gives you the feeling of dread. Your life is terrible, right? Oh my God, that's a siren. They know where I am. And, you know, you go down to the basement or something and you're under the house and you're shaking in fear and stuff like that. because there's sirens all day long of vehicles for all sorts of paramedics and whatever. That's not a very fun way to live, is it? And certainly there are those who feel this way. I used to feel that way, actually, severely. I went through a phase like that. Because in turning towards truth, I felt like this great dread, you know, that there's something that doesn't, you know, that was out to stop me. You can get into paranoia like that, and it's very miserable, very miserable. Now remember, Jesus was here. They tried to apprehend Jesus many, many times, and they were completely incapable of doing it. In fact, he said they couldn't lay a hand on me if it wasn't, you know, given unto them to do so by the script that Jesus was playing out. So, but now if he they wanted to seize him, and they couldn't find him, they couldn't do anything. So it's like that. He's not in the dream. They're only looking at dream figures, you know. So somehow I'm reassured that there's nothing to worry about. If that's the case, then what is it then that everyone then is trying to apprehend themselves, actually? And you just don't allow them to project it upon you. Everyone is in an apprehensive state of mind. They think God is out to get them. Because they think they found a flaw in God, and God's angry, doesn't want this flaw to be revealed. And they think that they're believing that their body is a revelation of the flaw, a flaw in reality, that all this is a revelatory evidence. So they feel apprehensive, like a God is out to get them. Try to deal with this apprehension by saying God's desire to destroy us needs to be, God needs to fulfill that desire, that angry desire. Then once that's been fulfilled, then God will no longer be out to get us, you know. So they have the sacrificial atonement sort of situation, which is the Easter story situation. The flaw has been fixed. And during their Easter vigil, I kept saying, you know, you can't. The mistake that we make, the key mistake, is we try to make illusions real and then fix them, get rid of them. And Jesus says in A Course in Miracles, that's a crucial mistake that we make, that we must see through this mistake and no longer do it. We say, yeah, death exists, but we've defeated it. We've overcome it. So in the Easter Vigil, it says Christ has overcome death. But I kept saying, no, there isn't any death. There's nothing to overcome. You don't make an illusion real and then overcome it. That just makes things worse. In our mind, it just makes our mental sanity even worse. It makes us feel really crazy. There's no flaw in reality at all. There's no such thing as death. No such thing as process at all. Time, space, process, or form. None of that is ever happening. So there's nothing wrong. Reality's flawless. There isn't any reason to feel frightened about reality at all. Nothing. There's nothing to overcome. So it's like people are apprehensive of what? Of their death or of losing death? This is a question here that's brought up by this whole situation here. It's kind of like we're trying to put death on someone else so it doesn't rest upon us. But as long as we're trying to do that, we're believing in death. So if you want to be free of this notion of death, just don't try to put it on anyone. Don't try to get rid of your death by putting on somebody else, because then you're believing that your own death is real. You can say, I don't have any death to put on anyone. It doesn't exist. So we're getting to the nitty-gritty. What did Jesus say? The final fear is death. And of course, a miracle says that. So we're at that, at the nitty-gritty here. The Easter Vigil thing, really highlighted this, is how they try to, magically deal with the notion of death. It's interesting, in that dream, I was fleeing from somewhere, in an orange, brand new orange VW Beetle, all right, it was brand new, just love, spanking, shiny, brand new orange. Now, isn't that interesting, because that was all the rage back in the 60s, the VW, the Beetle was absolutely the car. And you had these bright yellow, orange, blue, these different strong colors like this. And it still lives. We thought that it died out. The beetle died out. It's still here. It's still here, actually. I'm seeing more and more. So it's like it's what never dies. The car that never really dies. It's the same model, basically. And so it's like maybe it's symbolic of someone who's saying, no, I don't ever really die. In fact, I'm better than ever. In this fresh, brand new Beetle, but it's been around. This is something that has been around, previously. And there might be that, because this featured strongly in this dream, this orange VW Beetle. Maybe it means the deathless car. It's a car that just will never die. Here it is, 50, years later, and the car's still around and better than ever. Interesting. So yeah, it could be that we are now getting into this whole death thing. And this is going to be clarified. This will be clarified for us now. And these two teachers, both of whom identified one of them as Longchenpa, the other as Ananda Mahima, they both supposedly died, right? But here they are. Here they are. They're laughing. Say, I don't know. Don't have any concerns. Don't be concerned at all. Nothing to be worried about. It's almost like everyone would say, well, what if I could die? And then trying to push that off onto others. And then this is what causes their own supposed death. So if we just dropped the belief in death, we wouldn't have any fear. We wouldn't need to project it on anyone else. And therefore, we wouldn't. Jesus tells us that we get what we give to others. So if we're trying to give death to others, we will experience that for ourselves. But That doesn't make it real. It just means we're trying to get rid of something that doesn't exist. An imagined flaw. I may say, oh, I don't want to have that flaw. I'm going to give it to someone else. And then as soon as you do that, you feel that you have it yourself. You've given away something. How can you give away something unless you have it to give away? And so you believe that it's real. So by giving away illusions, we end up believing that they're real, and we end up acting them out as if they were real. So this body seems to undergo what we call death, you know. But it's very much along these lines, and we're just exploring these lines here. So if you're experiencing really heavy stuff right now, this is why. Death is coming up now to be examined. Great. This is the apocalypse. Wonderful. Like I say, let's get it on. I just met these two tremendous teachers who just, you know, laughed like, you know, just don't be silly. What do you, there's nothing to worry about. What are you, don't be concerned in the slightest bit. It's just, now we got it covered. Don't worry. It's nothing, no problem, no problem. So I'm sharing this with the world. This attitude that I experienced in the dream from these two great beings, that got into me a little bit, and I'm passing that on. There's some of you that are also getting this and passing it on. Those are the teachers of God. Those are the ones who are really helpful, actually. So as far as being difficult, I just take the same, wow, okay, wow. We're actually now looking at the very mechanism of what we call death and dying, and laughing it away. It's something that just is absurdly laughed away, or just dismissed like is nothing. This is the teachers, they act of this. Oh, you have that? Oh, no, there's nothing to it, don't worry. They didn't make a big deal of it at all. So it must be something very simple. It must be something very simple. There's a simple little mistake that we're making that once we see it, we just laugh and just say, oh, that's all there is to it. Really, that's all there is to death, is something, some little silly mistake, just like I wasn't putting ketchup on my hamburgers. I just said, oh, yeah, no wonder why it tastes bad. That doesn't taste right. How ridiculous. Don't wish death upon anyone, and then you won't be anywhere. You won't have it. The more we wish death upon so-called enemies, the more death pursues us. Video presentation an Easter vigil about God creating the world in 7 days, and then somehow they got into the Jews fleeing Egypt, and the parting of the Red Sea, of course, and then God coming in and destroying all of Pharaoh, destroying Pharaoh. Every single soldier and charioteer and everyone was wiped out, destroyed, killed. And then the Jews took great happiness and glory in God, saying that this is what God does for us. God annihilates our enemies. And their love of God is proved to them the greatness of God, that we can rely upon God to annihilate our enemies. Pretty interesting definition of God. So I was like, wow. And then there's this song we kept repeating, thanks, and all thanks, all praise, God's glory covers us, meaning that God, our God annihilates our enemies, and this is why we can trust in our God. But of course, if annihilation of our enemies is possible, then an annihilation for us is possible. Otherwise, how could we even speak of enemies unless we were afraid of being annihilated? So Jesus came to unravel this madness, really. And A Course in Miracles helps us unravel it. And truth helps us unravel it, and we are unraveling it. And so we're right here, right now, right in the midst of that. And so don't be concerned. Just like I ran into those two great beings, they weren't the slightest bit concerned. They acknowledged my so-called predicament. Just, you feel you're being like hunted and pursued, right? Right? Oh, don't worry about that. And they were so completely unafraid and joyous themselves that, you know, I just had to believe them. Like, well, they're certainly not ever frightened of, they don't seem to have any fear of being pursued, or it's impossible for them. I said, well, if it's impossible, then how is it possible for me? You know, if it's impossible for them, and they're speaking with me, and they're reassuring me, you know, they're basically saying, it's not possible for you. And this isn't possible for you. So it's good to have those kind of friends. It's great to have those kind of friends who reassure you that fear is impossible for you, that problems are impossible for you, cannot be. It's only when you are trying to find a flaw with reality and thinking that you found it, and you say, oh my God, I don't want that, that's terrible, I got to give it to someone else, that you basically end up confirming it for yourself. And how do we break this terrible cycle? By coming across those who are absolutely certain that, you know, there is no flaw in reality, there is no death, there's no reason for you to be frightened whatsoever. Keep in mind that Ananda Mayima said the only reason why she appeared to age and the body appeared to die was because that's what everyone here wanted to see. And since she had no agenda of what her appearance had to be one way or the other, it didn't make any difference to her. She said, it makes no difference to my spirit. My spirit's completely untouched by any appearance whatsoever. Whether the appearance is of a dead body or a live body or whatever, she said, it has no effect on my identity, how I feel, my consciousness at all. Nothing. So she said, it does all the same to me. She says, absolutely all the same. So if you want to see me get old and die, that's just the same to me as having me stay young and, you know, not die. Not identifying with any appearance. So, but she said, should you not want me to die, then the body would remain with you. That's no problem either. It's up to you. She's like, again, she didn't have any preferences. It's up to you what you want. I am whatever you take me to be. Take me to be an old aging body, then that's what you're going to see. And some, they didn't take her as a body at all, and they saw her as just this ball of light, this shimmering, glowing, golden light. And she said that's how she saw herself. That's how she saw all of us saw, didn't see us as bodies at all. It's the same thing as Jesus, exact same thing they said. Jesus said, I don't see any of you as bodies. I see you as balls of this glowing, shimmering, radiant, golden light that radiates to infinity and beyond, so to speak. No end to your radiation. Same thing Ananda Mayima said. So I see you as these beautiful ball or egg-like shape of golden glowing light. And she saw herself the same way. That's it. Bodies are just symbols, actually. But the body doesn't have to die. The body can just simply merge into the golden light. Just, it's like a fade in a video. It can just fade, it can just, the appearance can just crossfade right into golden light. There's no reason to junk it, no reason to attack it, no reason to try to give it away. The more we try to give away the body, the more we believe we are a body. So, we're already not a body, but to allow the appearance to begin to simply fade into light, just don't try to give the body away. Don't try to get death away. We're just looking at this. Don't worry about final answers here, because remember, we're not trying to answer questions. We're bringing up clarity, and then the wow about it. The very fact that we're able to look at this is a huge wow, isn't it? Without too much fear here. Remember, we can only give away what we believe we have. So if we're trying to give the body away, then we'll believe we have a body. We believe that we have something that can be given away. Something, some crystallized thing. But we're told that nothing ever crystallizes. So it'll click in. This whole death thing is very elusive. I've had it click in a couple times before, and then it disappeared again on me. I said, it'll click in again. You can't really force it to click in, the clarity to click in. It's not something you can force. It just so it's continued your discipline of the wow, the three-phase practice. Yes, I already know I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Yes, I already know there's no death that I can give away. I can't give death away. And then we think, I'm stuck with it. No, keep in mind that if we can't give it away, that means we must not have it. Same with sickness. If you think you can make someone sick, that means then you will believe you have that sickness. If you think that sickness is possible for someone else, then you will think it's possible for you. If you think death is possible for someone else, you'll think it's possible for you. Mind is one, reality is one. Whatever we believe to be true, for one, we believe it true for us. But somehow we think this is different when it comes to sickness and death and the body. You know, we think that somehow this is more difficult. And the key is to say, no, it's not more difficult at all. There's no order of difficulty in miracles at all. And of course, miracles are really just simply reminding ourselves of the truth, just asserting truth. That's all. They're not changing anything that's real, the nature of reality. It's not fixing anything. It's not getting, miracles don't fix or get rid of anything at all. They just remind us of that truth is true and nothing else is true. That's all. That's it. They're just reminders that truth is true and nothing else is true. Cool evening now. a storm came through today, a little bit of rain. Supposed to be one coming through tomorrow evening with actually some rain, half an inch of rain in California. That'll at least keep the vegetation green. It doesn't do anything for our runoff or reservoirs or anything like that. Gives a little drink to all the vegetation, which is good for the vegetation. But we're vegetation too. We need a drink too. So we're under the impression, you know, all this solemnity around the Easter, and all of this brings up this, you know, this tremendously intense notion of death and all this around this. But again, as I looking at all this, I said, hey, wait a minute. You know, actually, there's no difficulty, no degree of difficulty at all at getting free of the notion of death. There's nothing. Just there's no difficulty at all. But we've assumed that there's some great difficulty in this. But as Jesus said, there is no order of difficulty in miracles. None whatsoever. And this is what we need. Yes, I already know that there is absolutely no degree in difficulty in miracles whatsoever. Yes, I already know there's absolutely no degree of difficulty in miracles whatsoever. Yes, I already know that there is absolutely no degree of difficulty in miracles whatsoever. And maybe the dream that came up is they realized I'm about ready to be free of this, you know, free of this, of this no, false notion of death. And they say, apprehend him, apprehend him. We can't have a society that where there isn't death. You know, we have to learn how to deal with death successfully. Really? We have to learn to deal with what doesn't exist successfully? What kind of notion of success is that? That's like saying we need to adjust to our insanity, have a successful adjustment to insanity. How about curing insanity instead of trying to adjust to it, have a successful adjustment to it? But of course, in getting into this, you pay a price of these dreams and these apprehensions. You know, they do arise, but that's fine. It's the apocalypse. Let's get it on. Let's checkmate the whole situation. Checkmate. Defenses against fear are such that we've tried to stratify everything in the different orders of difficulty, thinking that this is a way to sort of parse it all out. Trying to find a flaw with reality gives us this, ultimately, this tremendous fear that God is trying to crush our awareness of this flaw. And so we've developed all these different levels of fear and levels of difficulty as a defense system. We think that some things are tougher for God than others, which makes us feel safer, right? If we felt everything is equally easy for God, there's no order of difficulty, how can we feel we have some defenses? How can we feel defended? The idea of defensiveness is we have a variety of defenses, and some, we say, what happens when one defense gets broached, we say, well, that's okay, because that was an easier defense. We have many, many levels of defense. And so this calms us down, right? We say, well, that's okay. That's just the first level of defense, and that's an easy one, but we have much more difficult ones to go. So defensiveness inherently believes in levels of difficulty. And so as long as we're trapped in this levels and orders of difficulty, death will then, this notion of death, this false notion of death, will seem like the most difficult. And this is the block in our mind. We say, well, this is just incredibly difficult. It's going to be incredibly traumatic. Look how they portrayed Jesus, the scourging, torturing scourging, and the crucifixion. You know, it's like extremely difficult. And so we have this enormous fear around this defense we call death. But we're saying is, well, God can kill the body, but it can't kill, God can't kill us. we're spirit, the one that has seen the flaw in reality. And so the body is just this defense, apparently. And the death of the body reassures us. Say, oh, you see, God now thinks that God has killed us, but we're not dead actually, and that's a defense. So the death of the body is like a very important defense that we have. We think that God wants to crush us, that we have discovered the flaw, the reality's flaw. That means that God really isn't God. And so we feel that God's an enemy now, that's trying out to destroy the one who's greater than God, who sees the flaw in God. And of course, we've just made all this up. We wanted to be greater than God, so the only way we could do this was to try and find a flaw in reality. And so we have all these different layers of defense. Sickness, all these terrible things that can happen to us, and vulnerable. So we need to have vulnerability to believe in defensiveness, right? That this is more vulnerable than that. Levels of vulnerability that makes us feel safe. Otherwise, we just say, you know, all defenses are exactly equal. And then we get this feeling of, uh-oh, you know, what if God breaks down that defense? I don't have anything other than that. So we want to make a vast, vast amount of layers and levels of defensiveness. And then finally, when we think that God finally breaks through all of them and finally destroys the body, and we want to act as if, oh, okay, God, you finally won. You've destroyed us. And yet, of course, we know we still live as spirit, absolutely, hoping that God doesn't know that. That's really something. And we think if we don't have the body to die, then God will recognize, oh, you must be spirit. I'm going to destroy your spirit, you know. But then, of course, since all is one, God would be destroying God if that was the case. And that doesn't happen. So we're just loosening up the whole frame around this issue of body and death. Now, the attitude of these two beings I met didn't seem to be contrived in any way. It wasn't like they were faking it or contriving it. It felt very natural to them, and they just dismissed it like with ease. In other words, this particular problem that I felt was so severe, they treated it as a mere trifle. But along with everything else being a mere trifle, they didn't act like anything really bothered them. Everything was all concerns were just a mere trifle, and they said, "Yeah, this too is just a mere trifle. Don't take it so seriously. It's just a trifle." In other words, there is no degree of difficulty to truth at all. This is just a symptom of believing in defensiveness, as you automatically are going to believe there's going to be some, you know, really really important defense, really severe defense that's really difficult to deal with, because we want to believe that it's difficult for God to deal with it, so we believe it's super difficult for us to deal with it. So the defenses that we've made are really just we believe that they're difficult for us, thereby, and then project that onto God and say, well, they must be really difficult for God then. But the truth is, they're not difficult for us at all. And of course, then we say, well, they're not difficult for God either, right? Well, God doesn't see any defensiveness in us at all. God sees us exactly as we are, knowing that nothing has changed. So, but we're fooling ourselves by believing that they're difficult, and therefore we feel safer from God attacking us. But once we see this dynamic, in a flash, we can recognize none of this is difficult. And this is what I saw in this Easter vigil. I said, well, wait a minute. All of this heaviness is not heavy at all. When I looked around, I saw everybody in there, and they're so, you know, engrossed in it. And I said, yeah, that's from one perspective, you can see it that way. And from another perspective, I saw you can just walk out of there. This was just like a mere trifle. It was just a little play some kids put on. A little street play some kids are putting on. There's nothing you need to say about it. It's a mere trifle. That's what Nisargadatta Maharaj says about this whole world, the whole situation. It's just a mere trifle. There's nothing to say about it. No need to comment on it. It's just believing in defensiveness is all. And so when we realize that the defensiveness is entirely a artificial construct of degrees of difficulty, you know, then where is the difficulty once we see that? This is what these spiritual beings, teachers, were conveying to me, you know. There's no reason to be concerned. Why are you concerned? There's no reason to be concerned or feel there's something difficult. There's no degree of difficulty to your situation at all. No degree of difficulty whatsoever. Now we might feel really afraid, very frightened about this, because our entire defense system is built on the belief in degree of difficulty. And then, of course, death, the body and death of the body seems to be the greatest defense of all. And so it seems extremely difficult to let this one go, right? And everybody's saying, you can't do that, you can't do it, arrest him, you can't let go of it, it's impossible, you know, danger, dangerous. We cannot let go of this defensiveness of death, this defense against God, God's presumed desire to destroy us. You know, we use a scapegoat. What's the body? What's a body? A scapegoat. That's why they use Jesus' body. What do they want Jesus for? Instead of listening to the truth, they wanted to use him as a scapegoat. And they said, oh, so God believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Okay, great. If we can get God to kill Jesus, then God will think that God has destroyed the Son, and we're safe then. This is the magical thinking that we were believing. And Jesus knew all this, and he says, oh, I'm showing you what's going on at the very root of your situation. And you don't understand it yet, but Holy Spirit will explain it to you eventually, gradually. And we're at that time now, the apocalypse, where all will be made clear, including death. Again, in the Course in Miracles, Jesus says the final barrier to your peace of mind, essentially, is this defense we call death. And so we're right here now, we're looking at this, you know, plain and simple. I had to suffer this chase and come across these two beings, you know, to highlight it here. But that's okay. That's the price you pay for doing this. You want to break the ice, you're gonna hit the ice. If you're an icebreaker, you're gonna hit the ice with your hull. It's gonna hit the ice, and boom! I mean, the ship's gonna be shaking, and boom! You know, it's you're gonna feel it. So let the wisdom that is in Christ be in me as well. Let the wisdom that is in Christ be in me as well. And these two beings were, you know, assuring me, you know, their wisdom, and you know, letting me feel their wisdom. Let the wisdom that is in the mind of Christ be in me as well. Be in all as well. Give it to all. If you give it to all, you must have it. So let the wisdom that is in Christ be with all. We don't need any defenses. We don't need any sacrificial atonement. We don't need to appease some furious God. We've never done anything to God. There isn't any flaw. We never found a flaw with reality. We've just been hoping to find one. But there isn't any. So God is not defensive. God knows there isn't any flaw with reality. So God knows we can't possibly find it. So God knows we're just on this odyssey of a dreaming that we think we're finding it, or we found it and we're trying to transcend it. God knows this is absolute nonsense. There isn't any flaw. So God's not defensive. God's not out to attack us. We haven't found any flaw. There isn't any. So why should God be angry? There's no cause for anger. What have we done? Did we find a flaw? No. Did we try to find one? Yes, but it's all completely futile from the beginning. Don't we know that God knows this quest is futile from the beginning? So is God worried about our quest? Not at all. Do we have to defend against an angry God that is desperate to stop us before we discover this flaw? You know, it's like there's a flaw, we've almost found it, and God is frantically trying to prevent us from finding it, you know. So we have God kill the body, we think. It's not God killing the body, we're imagining that we're dying, actually. But we think that God is killing the body, and we think, okay, so we say, okay, now God believes that God has destroyed our quest, of course. Secretly, we realize we're still alive, we're still spirit, and then we incarnate with another body. We say, we fooled God. God doesn't know about this. It's a secret. Reincarnation, it's a secret. God doesn't know about it. And many of the teachings don't even teach it, you know, as if God is ignorant of it. It's our little trick. It's our little secret. So we can continue the search again. And then God catch wind of it again, goes after this other body, kills this other body. We get another body and keep searching. We think we've almost found it, you know. And especially in this time right now, in the world, we think we've almost found it. We've almost got it. We've almost discovered the vulnerability of reality, we think. And so we think that God's really after us, really trying to get us now. So all the sacrifice is just defense. To throw God off the track. Throw God off the track. We think God is trying to prevent us from succeeding. And so we allow God to destroy all these bodies, so-called God. God doesn't destroy anything. Without we allow this, we bring about this play of destruction, claiming that this means that God thinks that God has succeeded in stopping us. And then while God is resting from all his destructivity, here we are, frantically, again, you know, getting closer and closer to finding the so-called flaw. This is all the dance of dream, of madness, actually. None of it is true, based on any truth whatsoever. God is not paying any attention at all to the dream. God isn't doing anything except the Holy Spirit saying, hey, you know, no reason to be frightened at all. God's not trying to stop us from anything. There's no reason for God to try and stop us from doing anything. We're perfectly free. God is all pure potentiality. Nothing can be harmed. Nothing can be threatened. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. So there's no reason at all to be concerned. God is not angry or trying to stop us, and we don't need to sacrifice bodies in the belief that this throws God off the track, like it's a red herring. You know? We keep throwing these bodies, corpses back at God, like on the path. The path is really just a path of corpses, the road of bones, really. And we just keep tossing these bodies back on the path. You know, fresh meat for God. We think there's this monster coming, God, this devouring monster wanting to devour us. And But God can't resist this, you know, dead body death. God stops us. I gotta devour this body. This is good. It satisfies the monster's appetite. So we just keep tossing these corpses there to slow God down. That's the path. And then we realize all this is complete nonsense. Where's the path? We don't need any path. We don't need a path to slow God down. We don't need to slow God down. We think we're going to be devoured. What's that? Oh, the flaw, you know. The awareness of the flaw. There isn't any awareness of the flaw. We think we're going to lose our identity, which we mean the I means the awareness of a flaw in reality. There isn't any flaw in reality. So how can we lose the awareness of it? We just have an awareness, just a blank awareness right now. I mean, as Jesus said, we're not experiencing anything. We're just kind of blank, aimlessly blank, meaningless, nothing. We're not seeing at all. We're not really aware at all, right? In this dream, it's a dream of just being unaware, basically. So how can we lose awareness of what doesn't exist? How can we lose awareness of what doesn't exist? How can we lose awareness of what doesn't exist? So we cannot suffer any true loss at all. Only setting down a fantasy, but that's not a loss of identity or awareness of what exists. So we're not being deprived of anything. We're just being deprived of being deprived, you might say. even not that, because we can dream of deprivation anytime we want to. We just decide that it's not that interesting. Believing we can be deprived is not so interesting anymore. So when you realize there's no God is not pursuing us, there's no reason to keep heaping corpses on the road path. But we don't have to keep scurrying along a path. It's only because we think we're being pursued that we believe there's a path. The idea of finishing a path, we think, oh, we finally stopped God. God cannot pursue us any further. There isn't any pursuit taking place. Except our own fear. Our own fear is pursuing us based on the belief that we're going to find a flaw, you see. But we're not. So the fear is not justified on the basis of any reality whatsoever. It's unreal. It has no foundation to it. So when we stop all that happens is just stopped. It's not stopped. Nothing bad happens to us. It's like ending a dream. The dream doesn't pursue us in reality, actually. How are we doing here? Okay, we're doing pretty good. Yeah, I was feeling so terrible. Starting this video out, I felt I couldn't do it, but I'm obligated to do this. And because, when you meet with these great spiritual beings, you're obligated to try to share as best you can the attitude, because certainly the attitude rubbed off on me to some extent. So I can't just say, well, I feel lousy, I'm not going to do anything. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to try. Also, I realized in the Easter Vigil, the whole story of the parting of the Red Sea, I was thinking like, isn't the ocean bottom going to be really muddy? How do they walk through that? Of course, well, the chariots got all stuck in it, but how do they, walking, the mules and the donkeys and everything they use, they didn't get stuck. But it's, don't bring up that kind of stuff, because it's part of a defense system. And those who believe that they're being pursued by God who's trying to annihilate them are very frightened indeed. So whatever it is, whatever stories they want to tell themselves and make them feel a little more safe, is okay. Don't try and tear them away from them. That's not right. So I don't have a negative viewpoint. I was just accepting of the whole thing. I understand what's going on. It's a dance of fear and how to deal with that fear. And so I treat everyone with compassion, and everybody treats me nicely, civilly, and we're all there to get free of fear, right? It's just that there's a right way to get free of it, and then there's a way that doesn't work. So what we want is to get free of fear. We all have the same goal. We want to be free of fear, don't we? And most of the world is still struggling with great confusion in this. We try to minimize the fear among us by being civil and nice to one another, but we're not doing anything about the real dynamic, underlying dynamic of it at all. And then thinking that somehow we can create a utopian society by leaving the underlying dynamic defensiveness, the idea of trying to find a flaw in God, flaw with reality, and all the fear that this brings up, and the defensive stratifications we need, the belief that all this is, you know, real and necessary. It doesn't touch that at all. And yet we want to build this utopian society based on just people being nice to one another. This is, doesn't work. Okay, this is folly. This is absolute folly. And yet, you don't attack those who are being foolish. You have compassion for them because, you know, they want to be free of fear also, of course. They just have to be careful in how you explain it to them because, again, you have to take a seemingly indirect approach rather than trying to demolish their defenses. Don't try to demolish their defenses. If they want to believe in you know, whatever their defenses are, okay, those will only be seen through when they realize there's no order, degree of difficulty in miracles whatsoever. And then the whole thing will just seem to be the sameness, and it's all easy. And they'll let go of it all at once, seeing it that way. So don't try to, you know, tear down the defenses of people because the fear behind that is extreme. They think God's out to annihilate them. So that's quite frightening. Again, we want to be greater than God. So we believe that, the only way to do it is to believe that there's a flaw in reality. It's the only way we can pursue this idea. There's a flaw. And so we believe there's a flaw. And then the only way that we can really maintain this belief there's a flaw in reality is to believe that God is desperate to stop us from discovering it. Because if God just was completely indifferent to this, we'd say, wow. And, you know, there probably isn't any flaw because God could absolutely care less, you know, about this notion. It pays no attention to it whatsoever. So we believe that God is like frantically trying to prevent us from finding this flaw. And then, see, this is where this whole fear thing gets going. And all this defensiveness, ultimately believing that we're some body and we have corpses to throw on the path. And of course, we are believing we're a body, so God believes we're a body. You see, if we realize, oh, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, it's like, wait a minute. When I throw the corpse on the path, God won't stop there. God says, well, I know that's not spirit. I'm after spirit. I'm going to keep pursuing spirit. So, of course, what people are saying in this world, the mantra is they're saying, I am a body. I'm not free. I'm not spirit as God created me. No, I'm this body now. So we believe it. So we believe then that God believes it. So if we say, well, if I believe it's true, then God must believe it's true also. At least that's what we hope. This is why we keep reinforcing this notion that we're a body. And this is why Jesus tells us the most important assertion we can make is say, I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And of course, the greatest fear we have is when we see death being exactly the same order of difficulty as all other defenses, which is zero. There's no level of difficulty. And that's like the shock, you know. That's the shock. We go past that shock point. We're free. No more concerns, actually. Because when we see death as the same as all other defenses, we say, oh my gosh, I don't have a defense system, actually, then. It's all completely flimsy. It's nothing to it. I can't protect myself from God. You know, he's like, oh my gosh. But remember, we just imagine that God is in high-speed pursuit of us, desperate to destroy us before we discover the flaw in God. But this is our imagination. God is not in high-speed pursuit of us whatsoever. God is completely at peace, at rest, as always, pure potentiality, is not going anywhere, not trying to stop anything. And then we say, well, if God's not pursuing us, what do I need all these defenses for? Exactly right. But then we have this problem of thinking, well, how do I get rid of these defenses? There's some are much more difficult than others. No, they're all of the exact same zero difficulty, actually. They're all the same. There's no order of difficulty in miracles. And a miracle is just seeing reality as it is. There's nothing that stands in the way that more stands in the way than something else, and nothing stands in the way at all, actually, of reality. So to see death is an absolute trifle, along with everything else, just a, you know, the same level of total trifle. There's nothing but the absolute ridiculous trifle. This is enlightenment. This is the beings that I met. This is their attitude. That's their attitude. They laugh at like it's just the absolute mere trifle. Same as all other trifles. I didn't impress them one bit with my big fear show. Wow, I wonder what the backlash to this one video is going to be. Oh my gosh. Let's see, I may have to, yeah, I have to, I was supposed to, get dinner, yeah, the backlash here. But maybe we can just full stop in the wow. Wow, we're able to meet with beings that have the right attitude, right? That they see everything as a mere trifle. All our defenses are just as equally mere trifles. They're just like, you know, just seems like that. Just ridiculous. They're all equally ridiculous. No order of difficulty whatsoever. We're able to meet with such beings, have access to such beings. We're able to pass on this meeting, share it with others in this world. How cool is that? That's fantastic, isn't it? Wonderful apocalyptic grace. I'm having more and more meetings with great spiritual beings now, enlightened beings, more and more meetings with them. And their mood of absolute reassurance and indifference to degrees of difficulty is, you know, tremendously helpful. So we're breaking the drought. We're breaking the spiritual drought. There's been a spiritual drought on this planet for quite some time. High pressure ridge has formed. High amount of pressure from cosmic corporate culture has been blocking the wonderful high indifference, which is like the rain, which nourishes us. This high indifference nourishes us with truth and helps us set all defenses down all at once, realizing there's no kathud at all. They're all as light as a feather. And there's that moment of dread of realizing there isn't any defense that is better than another. So I can't really have a defense system. And it's how we take that moment, you know, which is what's important. So we're preparing for that. This is the wow. We're just preparing. Wow. Yeah. We can have that moment. all defenses are equally untrue. There isn't any degree of setting down death is no more difficult than setting down any other a slight twinge of uneasiness or pain or discomfort or you know, the slightest of slight feelings that something isn't right. It's no different at all. There's no degree of difference at all. God is not chasing us. God is not in pursuit of us at all. So the idea of God having defenses to stop God is completely inoperable. It doesn't exist. So, you know, they're not even defenses. They're useless. They're all equally useless, all equally needless, meaningless. They're all equally meaningless. So we don't have this kathud, terrible experience. That doesn't exist. Setting them down. That's what I saw in the Easter Vigil. Wow. No, you just recognize that you were never, this was never needed at all. It's all equally not needed. And so there isn't any heavy situation that arises at all. Like I said, this shift in your mind of your attention is so smooth. There's no heaviness at all. It's as light as the lightest breeze. And you say, well, what happened? What happened to the heaviness? What happened to my defense system? How come I didn't experience any kathud? You know, and they say, whoa, wait a minute, what's going on here? And you get a little, you know, apprehensive, like, not really sure what's going on here. But now we understand what's going on here, so we shouldn't have that problem of abiding in this carefree condition, unconcerned condition. God is not pursuing us. We don't need any defenses to slow down God's progress towards us. We don't need to believe in a path. After all, only a fugitive believes in a path, right? Someone who's fleeing has to believe there's some path that they're going on that leads them to safety, and that whoever's pursuing them also has to run along that same path so they can throw up barriers. But truth is a pathless land. As Krishnamurti said, there isn't any path in reality at all. There are no paths. Or everything is a path. There's all paths. There's only one. It's just all one path, which means there's no real path at all. What is that? Someone walking on a path? I thought I heard someone. So obviously, you feel there's no path. Wow, how can I flee? You know, where can I run to? Don't need to escape or hide anywhere. So the belief in a path and all this ends easily, which is totally counterintuitive to what we think we want. We think that it needs to end in extreme struggle and torture and difficulty to reinforce our notion that we have a defense system, that it's real tough for God to you know, get through this defense system. it ends totally easily and simply without any effort on our part at all, really. So this extreme nonchalance that those two spiritual beings in the dream had is very important. Utter nonchalance. They knew that I wasn't in any trouble whatsoever. So this helps us out tremendously. So just because others don't may not believe in this, is because they haven't really looked at it. We had brunch this morning and at this plates and Easter brunch, and I had orange juice, and I drank the orange juice. I said, there's something wrong with this orange juice. It's fermented. It's become alcoholic. And then I asked the waiter, was there champagne in the orange juice? He said, no. And I smelled it, and I drank it. I said, there's definitely champagne in this. And he didn't believe me at all. And he's kind of like looking at me like, huh? And then I drank the others had glasses there. I drank the orange juice there. It was fine. It was out of the same pitcher. And I said, what's going on? It's weird. Then someone said, they must have not washed the glass properly, and there was champagne in the glass before, and so there's still a residue of champagne in the glass, so that's why you're getting the smell and the taste of champagne in your orange juice. And there definitely was, absolutely was alcoholic smell and taste in the orange juice, but the waiter, you know, didn't believe me, and I didn't press him on it, you know, but we understood why. But why, you know, why make a waiter think it's their fault or something? It's not the waiter's fault. They bring out a glass that wasn't cleaned properly. It's the kitchen staff. Same thing, the eggs were all cold. And because we got ones that were on the surface and it wasn't being heated properly, you have to dig down underneath. That's what's in contact with the bottom of the pan in these big buffet pans, because that's where the heat is coming, on the bottom of the pan. So you don't want to complain to the waiters, hey, the eggs are cold. Well, you have to dig down to get the warm eggs. So, you know, the people in the world, you just have to let them go about their lives until they really dig down. They're going to get cold eggs. And they complain to you, you know, about cold eggs. What can you say? Dig down. This whole situation is just this ridiculous defense system we've made, which really reinforces our belief that there is a flaw. God has a flaw. God's trying to stop us, you know, from finding out what that flaw is. That's a necessary belief to even believe there is a flaw. If God isn't trying to stop us and completely indifferent, you know, it's we easily could have to accept that there isn't any flaw. We're just making it up. It's just a made-up adventure. It's sort of a non-existent adventure, you know. The adventure of finding the flaw in reality. Only there isn't any flaw. So this is the adventure we're on, but it's not a very fun adventure. We don't really enjoy it that much. It's got all sorts of weirdness to it, doesn't it? Degrees of difficulty. Sure, God got rid of that one, but the next one's way more difficult. And ultimately, we can throw God off the scent entirely by believing that we're these bodies. God will never know that. God will then rest, saying, okay, I destroyed the spirit, no more worries. And meanwhile, we're still alive, embracing new bodies who are closing in on finding the flaw. And once we find it, we'll be greater than God. It's all a silly, silly stream, a story we've invented for ourselves to play out this adventure of trying to discover the flaw in reality. An adventure, which is, you know, adventure of really futility, experiencing futility. So this video could kick up a lot of wow for everyone, and it could kick up some backlash, but don't be overly concerned by that. There are beings who have utter unconcern, indifference, nonchalance about all our defense systems, everything. They know perfectly well. It's all nothing. Just a made up adventure, and they can impart their nonchalance and assurance to us and settle us down we have access to them in spirit somehow. And so we're not hopeless and helpless in this. We just merely need to maintain our full stop in the wow instead of panicking. Just say, okay, I'm just, I need to just get used to this wow. Because we're really into heavy territory right now. That seemingly heavy territory. But the territory of realizing there's nothing heavy. And that seems to be the heaviest of all for us, right? Absolutely. We think our safety depends upon heavy territory. Tougher, tougher, tougher territory. And what we're seeing is there's no tough territory at all. Actually. So that seems to be the heaviest of all for us, right? Like, that's the most frightening recognition there could possibly be for us, is that there isn't any heavy territory. There isn't any difficulty. That frightens us more than anything. And of course, this cannot arise in us unless we're clear about the whole overall situation, that there isn't any, God's not pursuing us at all. No need to, no reason to. Okay, I think I'm going to get called here. Hold on, for dinner. Yeah, okay, I'm coming. All right. Okay, yeah. Time to, where are we at? 150. Okay, well, that's pretty great. We've done a great job here. We just do a little cool down. So, I'm here trying to, I'm sharing, you know, as best I can. It's what I'm experiencing, and trying to share at least some nonchalance with you, and and this, hopefully this helps. This is what helps. This is what ultimately helps, as you come across these teachers, and utter nonchalance, no concern whatsoever. I say, wow, we must have great defenses. Huh? No defenses. Yeah. This is what helps us. This is what helps us. This is breaking the drought here. We're breaking the drought. But for sure, there's a wow, but don't worry, we'll be back tomorrow. Hopefully, God willing, back tomorrow or tonight or whenever with another installment of more reassurance. And just keep practicing this wow. When you're feeling troubled, just say, well, no, I can practice this. Wow, let me just practice this discipline. And then you're in charge. You're in charge. You're realizing that what you're feeling is just that you have so much success that you can hardly stand it. So you need to focus on that instead of the so-called fear. It flips the script. When the wow is because of success. You're saying, wow, I've just realized there isn't any degree of difficulty in setting down defenses at all. There aren't any heavy defenses. There's nothing heavy to set down. Wow, that's great success. Tremendous success. So just focus on the wow, realizing it's because of success. And that'll stabilize you. It'll stabilize you. You won't feel like you're the one who's in trouble. Say, no, it's lies that are in trouble, not me. No, I'm not in trouble at all. And so keep that, and then focus on the wow, neutral, just like reverberation. I'm reverberating with the shock of great success. That's the only problem I have. The only problem I have is a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem whatsoever. My continuity problem is the only problem I have. And just keep abiding in that. Don't let your mind get pulled into trying to defend. Don't be defensive. Don't get defensive. Then you're only increasing your fear. Don't get defensive. Just say, no, the only problem I have, I don't have a defensive problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The defensive problem doesn't exist for me. Therefore, it doesn't have any value. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And keep abiding in this non-defensive wowness, which is a reaction, elation. You say, whoa, that's so much elation, a little bit trepidation. I'm just letting it settle in. I'm just getting used to my success here. That's all. I'm not in trouble. No, I'm getting used to my success. That's it. And that puts you in a positive frame of mind. And then you can start flipping the script on all this, which is what we've done in this video. Really flipping the script on death. Absolutely, we have, haven't we? Which is really cool. Okay, and no troubles. No trouble at all. So just stay in this wow. Flip the script. Do some assertions. You'll be fine. Very great. All right. So, about ready to end this video. Now, will you suffer some? Probably. Yeah. But we're getting to it, okay? And I call upon all beings, enlightened beings, to help us out with their attitude of nonchalance. Let us have access to your nonchalance right now, okay? Knowing that this is where it's at now. Now we know where it's at, okay? Now we know. Having this great direct experience, I said, aha. Isn't it like, help me, help me, help me, help me defend, fight off the... No, it's the nonchalance that we need, this attitude of utter, total nonchalance. So pray for that. Pray for access to this nonchalance, that you experience this in your life, and when you go to sleep, you're dreaming. Pray for this in deep sleep, in sleeping sleep, in waking sleep, this attitude of utter, beautiful nonchalance, unconcern, and freedom from concern, that you get have access to that, and you start experiencing that. We pray for that right now, that all of us have access to this. Everyone in the world has access to this. This is our prayer. And of course, what we ask for others, we're asking for ourselves as well, being one with others. No separation. So we too will have access to it. Very great. That's it for this one.